This is the Korg Minilogue, an analog four-voice polyphonic synthesizer. I'm really excited to show it to you because it's really something special. Let's start off, as we always do, with the oscillator. Okay, right now I have oscillator 1 set to a sawtooth wave. Very nice sounding sawtooth wave. I want to show you this octave switch because it looks like it has four settings, one for each of these four octaves. But actually, it's just an up or a down switch. And you might ask yourself, okay, so why is that? And I've realized how beneficial it is. If those were four different settings, you're in the midst of performance, shifting things up just one tiny setting is not necessarily easy to do when you're caught up in performance. But with this, all you have to do is flick. And you flick as many times as you need to. It's super easy, doesn't require precision. So let's listen. Okay, we have that lowness, but we can also use this octave down here to place this sound anywhere we want. So we can get pretty low, down to the clicks. And conversely, right out of my hearing range, I'm just getting it right about there. So yeah. Huge range for this synthesizer, really easy ability to adjust the octave because this octave switch works the same way as this. It's all about just flicking it, which is super easy and actually kind of fun. And it looks really cool. Already, it has a really nice analog sound. Okay, now on to the waveforms. We've been listening to the sawtooth waveform. There's also a triangle waveform. Pretty heavy low end there. Nice. A very, very nice triangle, and of course, the old standby square wave. Your pretty standard square wave sounds fantastic. Now, okay, there were a number of polysynths in the late 70s and early 80s, and of the analog variety that you would get, you know, just your standard sawtooth and square waveforms. It's like that's all the waveform you needed. And why not? Because, you know, basically in subtractive synthesis, we're starting with a harmonic rich waveform like a sawtooth or a square. And then the rest of the timbral magic happens in the filter where we carve out frequencies using the filter. But that's a different paradigm. And actually, it's a better paradigm now in this synthesizer because these oscillators are capable of creating a vast array of wave shapes without even using the filter, which is really, really interesting and really, really useful. And I'm going to show you how right now. It's with this relatively innocuous shape knob here. What the shape knob does is changes the wave shape that you're dealing with. Luckily, we have an oscilloscope right here, which I absolutely adore. How great is it to have that there? I know a lot of people were like, well, you know, what can you tell from looking at a waveform? Well, we haven't really had the opportunity to tell a lot because we haven't had oscilloscopes all over our synthesizers. To be honest, I think this is a great educational tool, and we will come to be able to identify visual differences in waveforms in ways that are beneficial to us by being able to see what's happening. Okay, so we're starting off with this wave, this sawtooth wave, which we can see right here. I just turned the shape knob from one end to the other. You can see by turning that knob, we're changing the shape of the waveform which changes the timbre. And that's fantastic because we're still only in a single oscillator here. And anywhere along this continuously variable path, you can choose a waveform that you seek. And listen to what happens. We start off with this sort of the pitch that this sawtooth is. And by changing the wave shape, you can hear it gains a lower octave, which is really helpful right off the bat. It's like octave doubling. You've got a bigger sound. What a wide variety of wave shapes coming from a single wave shape. So that's why I was talking about earlier. You know, you're not bound to simple waveforms now. Now you can start off with complex waveforms that are interesting and more timbrally in the direction that you want to go. And of course, you're saying to yourself, wow, wouldn't it be cool if I could modulate that wave shape and get sounds like this? Well, we'll get to that later. Okay, let's listen to what the triangle has to offer in the wave shape arena. Again, a really interesting spread of timbres available from the triangle. And the square wave, basically what happens with the square wave is what you would want to have happen with the square wave. The wave shape isn't sort of changed. We're just getting a change in the pulse width. And you can see that change happening. And it goes all the way to a 0% or 100% duty cycle where you actually get it to be absolutely quiet, which could be helpful in different sounds that you make where you want the VCO2 to be quiet at some point, even though it's on without adjusting the mixer. If you have that situation arise, you can do this trick with it. And that's just a really pleasing sounding oscillator in general. Okay, so we've been talking about how many different timbres we can get with this thing just by going through these three waveforms and then messing with the shape. Let's not forget, we actually have two oscillators here. Already, you can see the complexity of the wave shape has gone off the chart here. Well, not off the chart, but you know what I'm saying. Listen to how thick that is. Very, very rich. And then we start messing with the wave shapes. VCO2 works in the same exact way as VCO1, so you've already been exposed to that. So you have this opportunity to create this incredible timbral diversity. And of course, you have the ability to change the octaves. So you've got these interesting timbres, and listen to how rich that is. It's just such a bright, brilliant richness. And And since you have these pitch knobs here, you have the ability to change the pitch of the oscillators. So you can create even broader, in a way you're adding, you can actually add notes of polyphony seemingly by doing something like this. Because then you have six different notes happening instead of the three that would be happening if they were playing one pitch. And of course, the trick I always show you, if you then turn down like the second oscillator that is tuned a fifth up, until it nearly disappears, you can still kind of hear it. It becomes an overtone instead of a different pitch. So your sound becomes richer. It adds a depth to it. So you have, like I said, 80 times already, this incredible timbral diversity. Oh, and I also want to point out, as I'm changing the pitch, I can actually see what the change I'm doing is portrayed over here on this screen. So I can get back to zero really easily and really quickly. Okay, so if that wasn't enough to really make you happy in regard to oscillator complexity. I mean, what do we even need a filter for at this point? We're creating all of these great timbres. Well, who doesn't love a filter? We'll get to the filter, but there's still more to do here in the oscillator.